As the sun sets on fall sports here at Seton Hall, the sun rises on the winter sports season. The men's and women's soccer teams have wrapped up their seasons, with volleyball remaining as the final fall sport still in season. The men's and women's basketball season gets underway this week with a pair of exhibition games, one per team, before the regular season commences. So, what went wrong for the men's soccer team this year? What's in store for the volleyball team as the season draws to a close? How will the men's basketball team fare in their exhibition game versus Misericordia? Will the women's basketball team start the season off on the right foot? My panel and I will discuss this all and more. I'm Jimmy Bliss, and this is Hall Talk. Hello and welcome back into Hall Talk. I am Jimmy Bliss, and I am joined alongside my wonderful duo of analysts, Chris Ellison and Ryan Johnson. Before we talk all things Seton Hall sports, we gotta ask you guys, how are you doing on this fine day?
I'm feeling great, you know, ready to talk sports and happy to be back with my guys.
Yeah, you know, I think the last time we were in the studio, the same panel. It's a fun episode, and I'm looking forward to another fun one.
It was, and we did have a great episode that time around, so let's keep up this good chemistry and start this episode off with someone that doesn't have such as good chemistry, and that's our men's soccer team, who lost the final game of the season against Villanova 1-0. They dropped to 6-8-3 on the season as they finished up the season. So first, we're going to talk about the game. Ryan, I'll go to you first. What went wrong in this 1-0 defeat to Villanova?
You know, the first half, it was really pretty boring, you know, not too many things going for either team. Three shots apiece, just pretty uneventful as a whole. We've kind of seen that as a theme for the Pirates this season. And then in the second half, they really stepped it up. They got 14 shots to Villanova's 8. They were much more aggressive. Both teams getting more chances, but Pirates really piling on the pressure a little bit to no avail. And Villanova coming in with just another devastating goal, 87th minute. And they got the game winner 1-0. And that just feels like it's been a theme for the Pirates all throughout the entire season. They just can't quite hold on. And that's what happened, you know, just another game where they just couldn't defend in the final minutes, and that cost them.
As my great colleague and fellow analyst, Ryan Johnston, would say, that loss was completely shambolic. Overall, I thought the Pirates completely came out sluggish. They didn't really have a sense of urgency, you know. First half, three shots on goal for both teams, you know, slow first half, but second half, they really picked it up, you know, energy got going, you know, juices started pumping up, flowing. They outscored the Wildcats 14-8, but, you know, they just couldn't manage to get one to go in. So sometimes you have those type of games where you shoot a lot of shots on goal and they just don't go in. So I think it was just that type of game for the Pirates.
And the Pirates have had a lot of games like that this year, Chris, where they've put up a lot of shots, but none of them have gone in the back of the net, or just not enough. My biggest takeaway was they just weren't clinical enough. Five shots on target, you're expecting to score at least one or two goals when you have five on target. But when you do keep C.J. Teebling, the best player on the team, by most people's opinion, on the bench, and he only played 39 minutes, that's the result you're probably going to get. He was a preseason All-American. He had three shots and one on target during his 39 minutes here on the pitch. So if you gave him, you know, 90 minutes, like, I think that he should have played, or at least close to 60 or 70, I could be talking right now about how C.J. Teebling was the reason why Seton Hall won this game. But once again, another issue with the formation and with the starting 11. Not the first time I'm saying this, but Andreas Lindberg, where he got his tactics wrong, and C.J. Teebling needed to play in this game in order for Seton Hall to have won it. And I know he's not been in the greatest of form this year. He has 4 goals right now, whereas he had 7 last season. But still, that's not a terrible outcome. 4 goals, second top scorer on the team. But anyway, I digress. And we are going to talk about the whole season now. 6-8-3, like I just mentioned, on the season, which is a very, very disappointing result as to where they were in the beginning of the season. They were ranked number 10 in the preseason, and it just took until week 4 for them to fall out of the top 25. So, Chris, I'll go to you first. What went wrong this season?
Honestly, I just think it's championship hangover. You know, we've seen it from so many great teams in various sports, and I think this team is also just playing down to their competition. You know, there's been a lot of close losses, 3-1, 2-1, 1-0. So I just think If we can take away a positive from this season, it can only get better. You know, 6-8-3 isn't a great record at all, but you start at the bottom and you work your way up, and I think this team will be great for years to come.
Yeah, the Pirates season as a whole was just very strange. Their defense was really suspect all year long. Chris, you're talking about how sometimes they just have games where you're going to be the better team and lose the game. It seemed like that was basically half the season for the Pirates. Like, they were the better team against Xavier, against Providence, against Fordham. That's just three games that I named right there. That's nowhere near the amount of games that they were the better team in. And it's really frustrating to me because they easily could have made it back to the Big East tournament, maybe even the NCAA tournament. But they just could not keep it together at the end of the games. They just, a lot of times, they couldn't find the net early on in the game, and they would just keep on piling more and more pressure to try and find it, and they would just never find it and end up losing the game off a counterattack. That seemed like it was just a theme for them the entire season long. So, very frustrating game. I think the Marquette game is what really killed their confidence. They were just absolutely destroyed in that game. They were down 3-0 for most of the game against a team they just beat 4-1, basically 3 months earlier. And I think that just killed their confidence for the rest of the season. Just a pretty disappointing season for the Pirates, if I'm being quite honest. I think we all had hopes that they were going to go back-to-back in the Big East and make the NCAA tournament again, but just not the season for them.
Extremely disappointing, to say the least there, Ryan. My biggest takeaway and what went wrong this season was the defense. Last season, Seton Hall only conceded 16 goals all year, which is a very, very good outcome. This year, it was doubled. They conceded 32 goals in just the 16 games that they've played, which, I mean, you can't do that if you want to be a championship-contending team. It wasn't too much of a talking point early on in the season when Seton Hall was winning these games 3-2, 4-2, because we were able to score on the other side. But when the goals started drying up on the opposite side and they just started coming into our net on the other side, you just can't have that happen when you're not a good offensive team. And that shriveled out so quickly. And it's kind of a really bad thing to see, because last season, like I said, 16 goals conceded. That was the biggest part of the team. Luka Don, Maurice Williams, partnership at the back, phenomenal. But I don't really know what happened between the two of them and how their partnership has deteriorated so quickly. But anyway, we're going to move on to the only active sport right now at Seton Hall, and that is our women's volleyball team. They just did defeat Georgetown 3-1 on sets, and they're now 12-14 on the season. And they do have six games left in this season. So, Ryan, I'll go to you first. Is this the momentum that this team needs to carry on to the Big East tournament?
See, I would love to say yes. I've got to say no, though. I mean, the Pirates right now, they're third last in the Big East. They beat Georgetown, admittedly a very important win, very important win. Georgetown is last in the Big East right now. It's not looking very likely, especially when they have Marquette and DePaul coming up. We'll get to that in a little bit. But they're 4-8 right now. I think the threshold for the conference tournament is at least six wins. So I think they have to win out for the rest of the season. It's going to be very, very, very difficult for them to do that against the caliber of these teams. As much as I want to say yes, I have to say no. I don't think that this win will carry them into the conference tournament.
I'm going to have to disagree. I 100% think this momentum will vault them into the championship play. Listen, it only takes one win.
That's crazy.
I get it. Georgetown is last in the conference. I completely get it. But it only takes one win. Coming off back-to-back losses against Villanova and Butler, I think this is the win that they needed. You know, get the juices pumping, get the team flowing. Morale is up right now, and I think they can ride that wave all the way to the Big East Championship.
And Chris, you took the words right out of my mouth. Right here, written right here, all it takes is one win to feel good again. So we're on the same wavelength here, where we're confident. We say that Seton Hall can go on and win. Ryan's a little bit more pessimistic over here, thinking that Seton Hall can't keep this up.
Did you guys look at the standings, or was I the only one that, you know, like,
This is where I'm going to throw you a curveball, because, no, I don't think that this is the momentum that the Pirates can hold on to for the rest of the season.
You're just...
I'm stunning you right blowing here, Ryan. I'm blissing you right in front of your very eyes.
Yeah, I just got bliss.
But they do have a bunch of very important games upcoming. They do play number 2 Marquette, number 3 UConn, number 1 in the Big East, Creighton upcoming. So between their final 6 games, a lot of big dogs that they have to contend with. And moving on from that as a whole, how do you think the games against Marquette and DePaul will go? These are the games that are going to be played on Friday and Saturday. Chris, I'll go to you first. Do you think that Seton Hall gets a win this weekend against either Marquette or DePaul?
Honestly, guys, I think they get a win against both. You know, Marquette is 19-4 on the season. That's going to be a tough matchup, probably the toughest we've had all year. But like I said, again, we go back to the previous point. It only takes one win to really get somebody going. So, you know, I'm gonna score predict. You know, I'm going to go 2-1 for the DePaul matchup and 3-0 shutout for the Marquette matchup.
Wait, 2-1?
2-1.
You mean 3-1? It's 3-6-1.
3-1.
Okay. Yeah, 3-1. I mean, I would never trust you in a bet, to be honest with you. I just wouldn't, like, I mean, if we're looking at it realistically, right, Marquette is probably the second or third best team in the conference right now. Like you said, they're 19-4. They've also had 6 days off. The only advantage that Seton Hall has over them right now is that they're at home. And if we saw the last time that Seton Hall played a team of Marquette's caliber in Creighton at home, they lost in straight sets. Wasn't even close. In the third set, it was like 25-9 or something like that. Not even close in the slightest. It's not a slight to Seton Hall. I think they're a bit outmatched against Marquette. And for that reason, I think because they've also had rest, I think it'll go 1-3 against Marquette. I don't think it'll be quite as dominant as it was against Creighton. But DePaul the next day, they're going to be tired. DePaul is no slouch. Like you said, Jimmy, I have it on my notes too. These are top dogs in the Big East right now. I think it's going to be another 1-3. I think they're going to lose both matches 1-3.
I agree with you in some terms here, Ryan. I think that they're going to go 1-1. I think Marquette's just a little bit too good of a team. They're number 2 in the Big East, whereas Seton Hall are almost bottom dwellers, a third to the bottom. So it's kind of a David versus Goliath kind of thing right there between the two of those teams. With DePaul, they're 13-11, so they're just a little bit above 500. I do think that Seton Hall is going to beat DePaul, but I do think they're going to lose against Marquette. Those are my final reactions to this. But anyway, we're going to move on to the winter sports season now, boys, and we're going to talk about the men's basketball team. They are currently playing against Misericordia, and at halftime, it was a pretty good lead for Seton Hall. But Ryan, I'll go to you first. What are some of your things that you're expecting for this exhibition game that's being played as we currently speak?
I mean, let's be real here. Okay. It's Misericordia. We should be beating them by at least 30. All right. I won't accept anything under 30 points. Not a single point. Not 29. Okay, Christopher, not 29 points. I need 30 points, 30-point victory. All right, and they're on track to do that, like Jimmy said. Bryce Aiken was killing it at halftime, 11 points. I don't even think Miles Kale or Jared Roden have even played a single minute. They weren't on the stat sheet at all.
Oh, Jared Roden actually twisted his ankle on Monday during practice, so he's not going to be playing in the exhibition game or probably the first game of the season.
All right, well, thank you for the update. I guess that's why, but just the fact that they're beating them by that much without Jared Roden and Miles Kale boosts my confidence in them even more. I really liked what Alexis Yetna has been doing. I think he has something like 7 points, 6 rebounds at the half. Super high-energy guy. I'm loving what I'm seeing from him in the scrimmage and the exhibition. Going to look forward to watching him play all season long. Yeah, I mean, we should be beating them by 30, and right now we are, so I'm a happy camper.
I have to agree. You know, Misericordia is honestly nowhere on our level, so we should be beating. I'm going to go 40.
Ooh.
Not 39, 40. But, you know, I'm really excited to see what this team can do this year. I think we have a young team, energy's high. You know, my early pick for player of the year is Bryce Aiken, and I'm going to throw Jared Roden in that conversation too. I think these two players are going to have a very, very good season. I think their leadership skills are going to show out this year. You don't agree?
Bryce Aiken, that's a hot take for player of the year, man.
Listen, revenge tour.
I mean, I hope he does well, but That's, hey, you do you.
My story. Look, he was injured last year, didn't really get to show what he could do. So I think this year, fully healthy Bryce Aiken is gonna take the Big East by storm. And let's not forget Jared Roden either.
Do you think he'll start over Jameer Harris?
Yes.
Wow. Yes. Okay.
Yes. 100%. 100%.
What about Kadari Richmond?
Book it right now.
What about Kadari Richmond?
100%. He's a starting point guard for the team.
I mean, I don't know if I agree with you, Christopher. I don't know if I agree. I hope he does great, you know, but I, like I said, I do not trust you with any sort of bets at all. Like,
well, Bryce Aiken did come off the bench today. It was Jameer Harris that got the starting nod. So maybe Bryce Aiken will be the sixth man of the year here. I don't know about being the Big East player of the year. And everyone knows I'm the biggest Bryce Aiken fan that you'll ever meet. I love the guy. I think that he's going to do so many good things this year. And I think coming off the bench after Kadari Richmond will be very, very good for him. I'm excited to see what he does this season. He had 11 points at the half. I believe he had three threes already made pretty early on into the game. I was listening to the WSOU broadcast with Michael Stamm and Chris Kiley. And Michael Stamm and Chris Kiley were just talking so much praise about Bryce Aiken. I think it's going to be a big year for him. I think that Kadari Richmond's going to have a huge year as well. I heard a few steals from him early on in the game as well, bringing up transition points for the Pirates, which is something that the Pirates didn't have a lot of last year, not a lot of turnovers that they forced. So definitely something that Kadari Richmond brings to the table. But anyway, we're going to move on from the exhibition game to the first regular season game of the year. Chris, I want to go to you first. What do you think is going to happen on Wednesday night when the Seton Hall Pirates take on the Fairleigh Dickinson University Knights?
Predicting a blowout. We're going to go back to Ryan's point, 30, not 29. 30 points, 30-point blowout. I just don't think the Knights have enough talent to compete with us. And, you know, I really think we're going to come out with a win on this one.
You guys want me to do it again? It's Fairleigh Dickinson, all right? We should be beating them by a lot of points if we're being real. I mean, this team went 9-15 last year. They're just not in our league. This is not Big East competition. This is a warm-up game. Like, Chris said this should be a blowout, 30 points. That's what I expect. I should be expecting in the least from a team of this caliber. I think 30 points shouldn't be too tall of a task for them.
I agree with the two of you. I think that Seton Hall gets this win. I think that they start the season off right. And actually, both of my brothers did go to Fairleigh Dickinson University, so it's a little bit of a brother rivalry here. They did go to the other campus. They went to the Forum Park campus, not the Metro campus, but still a little sibling rivalry. I think that Seton Hall, since they've had historically the numbers on Fairleigh Dickinson, they've led the all-time series 4-2. I'm going to expect that to go to 5-2 for Seton Hall. I think they're going to win by 25, 30 points this time on Wednesday evening. Jared Roden or not, better team from top to bottom. But anyway, we're going to transition to our last sport of the discussion, and that is women's basketball. And they also do have a tune-up game, an exhibition game, where they will be playing St. Thomas Aquinas on Friday at noon here at Walsh Gymnasium. So, Ryan, you are the first to answer this question. How do you think that the Pirates should approach this game?
I think they should really look at it as a chance to get their new transfers integrated, you know? You got Katie Armstrong, Sydney Cooks, Ariel Cummings. I mean, these are three huge transfers coming in trying to replace a huge gap in the team in Desiree Elmore leaving. And some of them, like, quite frankly, Katie Armstrong, she didn't look super comfortable in their blue versus white scrimmage. She did not have the best blue versus white scrimmage. And I think she should be a pivotal part of this team in this season. You know, she's got a lot of wing scoring that they're going to need to make up. I think that they should look at this game as a chance to just get all the transfers situated almost. It doesn't matter. It's not going in the column whether you win or lose. You should be winning either way, whether the transfers are comfortable on the team or not. But I think that they really need to get the ball to Katie Armstrong, Sydney Cooks, Ariel Cummings, try and make them feel more comfortable within the system and within the team.
Completely agree. I think this is a game you really want to try out some new sets, some, this game doesn't really count for anything, like you said. So I think this is the game where you try out some new sets, try out everything you've gone over in practice, whether it works or not. This is a game where I don't want to say let the foot off the gas, because you should never do that against any opponent, but this is a game where you can really sit down and look at, okay, look, the mistakes happen, they happen, okay, great, let's move on and make it better.
Yeah, I agree with you too, and I think that something that should happen this game is not a heck of a lot of Andre Espinoza-Hunter or Lauren Park Lane. We already know what they have to offer, so I want to see what other perimeter players can do, like Maya Maya Bembry, I think, will have a good year this year. I think that she needs to have a good game in the Friday exhibition game. And Desiree Elmore, like you mentioned, Ryan, she is gone now. She had to transfer away. So maybe potentially Maya Bembry steps in and takes a little bit of the load off of those two players I previously mentioned, and Andre Espinosa-Hunter and Lauren Park Lane. I think Maya Jackson could have a good game as well. I think she's an excellent defensive player, and she'll only improve offensively going forward in her junior year. But our final topic of the day is the game that actually will kick off this season for the women's basketball team. They are going to play Mount St. Mary's and Walsh Gymnasium on Tuesday night. I'll actually be on the call with Chris Kiley for that game. So, Chris, I'm going to go to you for this final question. Do you think that Seton Hall is able to get the season off on the right foot? Do you think that they're able to take down this team?
Most definitely, most definitely. I think this is a championship team that we're seeing. But what I'm really excited for, now I'm not really excited for the win or loss. I'm really excited to see how the two leaders of the team, Lauren Park Lane, Andre Espinosa-Hunter, how they come out the gate, how they balance scoring for themselves and getting their other teammates involved. I think that's the next step they both have to take. And I'm really excited to see what a summer off has done for them and the team as a whole.
Yeah, you know, this is a big season for the Pirates, really. I don't want to say, definitely not their last chance with Laura Park Lane, but their last chance with Andre Espinosa-Hunter to really make something happen. And coming into this game, you should just have swagger in your step, quite frankly. That's the way I'd put it. You should just have swagger in your step. Lauren Park Lane, Andre Espinosa-Hunter, both on award watch lists. They're both top 10 players in their respective positions in the nation. And coming in against a team like Mount St. Mary's, I don't really know what the NEC has to offer. It's not what the Big East has to offer. It's just that simple. Pirates went 14-7 in the Big East, and they arguably improved in this offseason. They should be dominating this team. I'm not too concerned about it.
So quick score predictions for you guys. Do you think this is going to be another 20-30-point game, or do you think that it's going to be closer than that?
Should we bet the whole house on it?
Yeah, 30.
45.
Wow. Okay, that's a big number. Okay. I will not be betting that number in Vegas there, Chris. But anyway, that will wrap it up for our edition here of Hall Talk here at Pirate TV. I am your host, Jimmy Bliss, joined alongside Ryan Johnson and Chris Ellison. As always, thanks for watching. Stay safe, wear a mask, and have a great rest of your day.